Let me begin with a numbers recap. We've identified about 20,000 objects orbiting the Earth, of which only 2,500 are operational satellites. Question: what are all the rest? Basically, junk that nobody wants. You launch a satellite into space with a non-reusable rocket? Junk in orbit. You eject part of your load? Junk in orbit. Your satellite is obsolete and you stop using it? Junk in orbit. There's an accident and your machine explodes? Lots of junk in orbit. The amount of debris floating above us has been growing for decades, and sending up a colossal number of new satellites could awaken a monster. A monster that won't just devour the young mega-constellations. It'll snap up every satellite out there. We're talking about the ultimate threat. This video is the last in our series about the risks of mega-constellations like Starlink. I highly recommend watching the others first. These videos have already ruffled some feathers, judging by the comments, so please hang on until the end and hear my closing thoughts before you freak out. But first, let me add some more fuel to the fire. While the other mega-constellations are still hatching their plans, Starlink already has more than 780 satellites in orbit, and ultimately aims to add another zero to the number of objects in space. Is this the beginning of a space junk wave? Actually, no. Those 40,000 potential satellites won't stay in orbit forever.
But let me be the one to explain this.
Hi, I'm the Spanish Elon Musk. You may remember me from other times when I promised scientifically unfeasible things, or from the tweets that made people question my emotional stability. My employees just love me. Here at SpaceX, we really care about the space junk issue. That's why we've placed our satellites in the bottommost LEO section, practically the lowest altitude at which you can orbit. Why? We know our Starlinks will eventually run out of fuel and technology. So when we want to retire them, we just give them a little nudge with the thruster, and the planet will recycle the junk as it should. And if, by some weird fluke, we lose control of the device, atmospheric drag will naturally deorbit it in 1 to 5 years. Much better than the 25 years recommended by institutions. That's precisely why our satellites are here, at the bottom of the LEO region. At the SpaceX, we want to ensure a clean orbital environment. Elon out.
Well, thanks Elon, but I'm not so sure about that. I mean, kudos on the deorbiting plan and all. Other mega-constellations should take note. OneWeb plans to put its satellites so high in the LEO that if they lost control of one, it would take centuries to re-enter the atmosphere. So cool, no complaints from me in that regard. What concerns me are the active satellites. But first, let me point something out. Why is space debris a problem? Basically, because of its speed. Nothing stays in orbit unless it's traveling incredibly fast. So imagine what happens when two objects moving at several kilometers per second collide. The result is dozens of times more lethal than a speeding bullet. For example, the Sentinel-1A satellite was damaged by a particle smaller than 5 millimeters, less than half the size of your pinky finger. Think of how something that tiny can have such a huge impact. And there have been worse events. The decommissioned NOAA-16 satellite had a run-in with something bigger, producing 357 identifiable pieces of space debris. And here's part of the problem. Junk breeds more junk. A collision sends deadly bullets flying, which collide with other junk and create more deadly bullets. These bullets take a long time to reach their targets. In the LEO, they roam across an area 4 times larger than all the dry land on Earth. But give them time and they'll find a mark. And the higher the concentration of junk, the more likely this will become. More lethal pieces will destroy satellites, which will create even more pieces headed for some future victim. An exponential domino effect. A cascade of collisions that will end up destroying every object in orbit. And what's worse, prevent us from sending new ones up. Destroy something on Earth and friction with the air will make the fragments fall. Do it in the LEO region and the fragments will go on spinning for years. Up higher, they'll stick around for centuries. A cloud of space junk is like a never-ending explosion right in front of our only gateway to outer space. Why send up new satellites if they're just going to be destroyed and increase the amount of space debris? You might think we could sweep up all these fragments, but right now, that's technologically unfeasible. Most pieces of space debris are only a few centimeters across or even smaller. And those fragments are so numerous and so scattered that going up there to collect them, however you go about it, would be like trying to filter the ocean with a kitchen strainer. It seems like our only option is to wait a few centuries until the slight atmospheric drag causes most of the debris to fall back to the planet, which would deprive us of many of the services that we all enjoy today. This scenario is the consequence of the Kessler syndrome, named after the guy who saw this space junk problem back in the 1970s. He predicted that these collisions would begin to happen around the 1990s. Today, they're routine. In the last two decades, we've registered about 11 unintentional collisions every year. The ESA says that the probability of collision has practically doubled since the beginning of the century. Even the International Space Station now has to dodge an increasing amount of space debris. One recent close call was with a fragment nobody knew existed until that moment. The process is already underway. That's why space agencies hustle to prevent it. For starters, they recommended cutting back on the amount of space debris we leave behind. And it's not going too badly. The number of fragmentation events appears to be decreasing. However, our friends, the Mega-Constellations, could alter the equation. It's not just that by putting more targets out there, you increase the likelihood of collision, catalyzing the reaction. You're also increasing the risk of collision with other satellites. See, this is how space debris has evolved over time. This spike here is partly due to the destruction of the Fengyun 1C. The Chinese government wanted to test their satellite system and smashed the device into over 2,000 detectable pieces, although the real number is estimated at around 40,000. Genius. But this increase right here corresponds to another event. In February 2009, two decommissioned devices, a Cosmos military satellite and an Iridium telecom satellite, collided, leaving more than 1,600 fragments in orbit. The collision surprised a lot of people. These were registered objects whose orbits were known and kept up to date. The probability of them colliding that day was just 3 in 100,000, three times less than the chance of being struck by lightning. That same day, there were objects whose odds of crashing were 10 times greater, and yet it happened to the Iridium. Sheer coincidence? Or perhaps not. Some scientists suspect that the Iridium collision could have been anticipated, that our prediction systems may be too conservative or unreliable and need to be updated and improved. And this is the scenario in which people want to send tens of thousands of satellites into space with intersecting orbits in a region already clogged with countless other objects. Experts wonder, are these really the best possible designs? Or are we overlooking some of the risks?
There's nothing to worry about. Our satellites are equipped with an autonomous collision avoidance system that uses data sent straight from the US Department of Defense.
Yeah, Elon, but the Department of Defense didn't predict the Iridium crash. Maybe the radar system shortcomings could be remedied by networks of civilian trackers who keep an eye on satellites. But there are lots of interests at stake. Many governments have spy satellites they don't want to be made public.
So this whole plan, is it really safe? And this is precisely the point that I want to make. These videos and that tirade against technological progress, or a hate campaign specifically targeting SpaceX. I never said that Elon Musk reminded me of Lex Luthor. My goal with these videos is simply to show you the bigger picture. Specifically in this context, where SpaceX tends to be idolized. Their achievements are undeniable. Thanks to them, lots of people have renewed their hopes of conquering space and their dreams of a futuristic, interplanetary future. A future where all these problems we're talking about will be easily overcome with things like telescopes on the moon. That's cool, but the fact remains that it's still a dream, and we can't make decisions about real problems based on the dream someone's selling you. Harming basic science is a real problem. Making it harder to detect meteorites is a real problem. Increasing the risk of collisional cascading is a real problem. That's the key word, risk. I'm not opposed to a company providing internet access to anyone willing to pay for it, but their infrastructure entails risk that I think we all need to be aware of. Who knows? Maybe in the future they'll figure out how to make Starlinks incredibly small or reduce the number of them in orbit without compromising the service. But we don't live in that future. It also pains me to know that some of you feel like I'm putting you between a rock and a hard place, as if you had to choose between quality broadband internet for everyone and safeguarding ourselves against all the problems we've discussed. It's not a neither-or situation. You don't have to pick just one. Broadband technology already exists and, yeah, it's going slowly. There's a lot of infrastructure yet to be built. But statistics show that every year the percentage of the global population with high-quality internet access is increasing. Now, could mega-constellations dramatically improve this trend? Yes, perhaps. But we don't know if everyone could afford to pay for it. Remember, broadband internet isn't free. And it would mean running all the risk we've explained to you. Is it really worth the risk? I leave that for you to decide.
In fact, not long ago, the American Astronomical Society published some articles analyzing how affordable Starlink might be in countries that need more internet access. This graph says it all. From bottom to top, you see countries ranked by the number of people with internet access. The United Kingdom is way up there. Ethiopia, not so much. From left to right, we basically have the purchasing power of an individual in that country compared with the cost of an annual subscription to available internet service. The estimated cost of a Starlink subscription is $60 to $80 a month. For an American, that's nearly 1% of their income. For someone in Tanzania, it's 70%, making it impossible to afford. In other words, on this graph, the countries that most need a service like Starlink and can afford it are the ones in this quadrant. And it turns out that there are already service providers in those countries which offer cheaper internet than Starlink's estimated cost. Of course, this doesn't mean Starlink can't offer better, faster service at a higher price that would really have a positive impact and improve internet quality, which, as you know, comes in very handy for watching videos like this one. But the thing is, I'm afraid the argument that mega constellations will bring internet access to people who can't have it right now doesn't hold much water.
I don't believe anything will stop the deployment of all these new mega constellations. So on this channel, we'll keep you updated of their progress and their positive and negative consequences.
That's all for today. And remember, if you want more science, just hit the subscribe button. Thanks for watching.